God, my God, I cry out. Your beloved needs you now. God, be near, calm my fear, and take my doubt. Your kindness is what pulls me through. Your love is all that draws me in. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my is what pulls me up. Your love is all that draws me in. I will lift my eyes to the maker of the mountains I can't climb. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging. I will lift my eyes to the calmer of the oceans raging wild. I will lift my eyes to the healer of the hurt I hold inside. I will lift my eyes to you. I will lift my eyes, lift my your beloved needs you now.
And we've got to acknowledge Beverly. She's been a very busy girl. Very busy girl. So she participated in a stand, an evening of stand, which was a commemoration of the 50 years after the Stonewall event. We celebrated that on, and celebrate, that sounds kind of weird, doesn't it? It's like, usually we think of celebration like a party. Celebrate, to celebrate means to honor. So to honor that occasion in history that happened at Unity of Linwood, and she and Garnet were excellent. She also did an interfaith celebration with Patrick and some others yesterday. And then she's here just, you know, making up music, and it's really great. So I have to tell you that my husband says that he is the Beverly and Garnet first fan. Like he's the first fan. He wants credit. So I was at the stand celebration. Honoring on Friday night. We're supposed to give small talk, 5 minutes. Tim went with me. He doesn't often get a chance to, but timing with horses worked out, so he goes with me. We go to P.F. Chang's for dinner, and we go to that event, and it's wonderful. We get in the car. I'm expecting, honey, great job. Oh, no. What he said is, Garnet and Beverly just get better all the time. Not that I think that they don't get better all the time, but what about me? Well, all the ministers went a little long. Anyway, so it's just a sort of a minister thing. I swear I did not go over except maybe by a minute, but that's just neither here nor there. It was really a privilege to be there. I did not know much about what we now call Pride Month or the Pride celebration. I just thought it was an opportunity for the people I know and love to get dressed up and march around. How many of you, well, I mean, come on. I didn't know about Ramadan either. I mean, you know, you don't know till you know. I come from Springfield and Eugene, and in that time when I was growing up, if you were gay or lesbian, you weren't out. So I honestly thought that they lived in other cities. I didn't have anything against them, they just weren't in our town. I moved to Seattle with the March of Dimes. I got a really good deal with an apartment from my boss's son on Capitol Hill. It was like so intriguing. Like, why didn't anybody notice me? I was so cute. You know how waking up takes a long time. And what I would really, I guess I'm just giving you the sort of the funnier points of, I had no idea about Stonewall. I really didn't know what happened 50 years ago. I didn't know that it was the impetus for people who weren't whatever the norm is. It's such a long description now. To say enough is enough. Enough with this discrimination. No, it wasn't just discriminatory. It was brutal. Enough. Sometimes you just have to say no. That was the beginning. So I got to be woke up and realized how naive I had been and maybe sheltered. One of the speakers was Linda Spencer, and she came to Bellevue Unity the same time that I came to what was then called the Seattle Science and Mind Center. It was in the Northgate area. We came the same year. I had no idea that she had such a hard time. When she was hired, she could not admit that she was gay or they would not have hired her. She couldn't say it out loud. I had no idea that churches would be that way because I don't know that when I was at the Science and Mind Center, it looked to me like there were probably some gay people there. I don't know. Didn't matter. The reason I know there were gay people is because people would sneak over to me and say, you know, there's a lot of gays in this church. And you really should do something about it. And I said, well, I think you really should leave. Because if it's bothering you, obviously it's about you. Unfortunately, she wasn't getting that reaction. And when she was found to be having a relationship with the bookstore manager, there was mediation and upset. And I mean, wow, that's to love, to be in your family. Because to a minister, the church becomes their family. And to have people nipping at your heels, that must have been very, very difficult. I'm so sorry for her. I'm sorry that that had to happen. But I'll tell you what was happening in my neck of the woods, which was Seattle. Actually, she was told she should go across the bridge to her kind. I know. People are so... What? I thought we're humankind, but anyway. I love naivete. Sometimes God just blesses you with a little naivete, right? But when these people were saying to me, you know, there's too much of this in our congregation and too much of that, I remember having the thought, and this was my intention, that we would have a church where it just didn't matter who someone loved or how they loved them. That we would get to the place where it became invisible. And it pretty much does. I mean, maybe you're seeing stuff, but out of my naivete, it's just like we're just human beings with faces and great hearts. And I know that some people can't tell, just like me. I can't tell, because they'll sneak over to me and say, whose team do you think they're on? Should I ask them out? I don't know, ask them out. People are flipping teams all over the place. I mean, just go for it. Jeez. I mean, is that not true? Anyway, I just have a lot more respect for what people are doing this weekend than I did. I guess that's what I want to say. It's more than a party. Some people may treat it like a party, but it really is a commemoration of a national coming out and a showing up for truth, which leads me to my talk. There were a number of us, and we were given 5 minutes to speak from our faith tradition about this thing called gay pride and how we would take a stand or fall down. And what I got to say is that our particular religion is called a lot of things, but it's sometimes called a new thought tradition or new thought church, a new thought philosophy, which basically means new thoughts, like have one. Now, it seems funny, but most of you, if you're really paying attention, you haven't had a lot of new thoughts. What the mind wants to give you are those thoughts reworked. And that the mind has a tendency to just turn things over and over and over. How many of you have known that? You turn things over and over and over, and it just becomes a habit. It's not a new thought. So our mind does not give us new thoughts. And oftentimes, even if we're not having our old thoughts regurgitated, we're having the thoughts of our family and our friends and those people who told us things in a dynamic way that we latched onto, and their voice will show up. All of a sudden, you're hearing your mom or your teacher or somebody that was down the block or whatever, and those aren't new thoughts either. New thoughts happen when you're willing to be inspired by that which is always in the creative stage, that is always the impulse for evolution. That can be a new thought. It happens when we're listening, and sometimes that still and listening happens because we're stuck and we're wondering how to get out, or we've had enough, or we're just like, this is just too much, I can't stand it, and then finally we just become still and a new thought happens. New thoughts happen from above. New thoughts are of God. If you've had a wonderful inspiration, then thank God, because what we give our attention to increases, what we praise becomes more, and just say, wow, I'm so grateful. Which reminds me, and this is what I then went into, which reminds me of the celebration honoring we will have in a few days, which is the 4th of July. And I am just always impressed with it. I'm dumbstruck with that. Talk about a new thought. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. That was a download from heaven, because nobody thought that in the world. It was not self-evident. What was self-evident is there's those who rule and those who are subject to. There are those who have and those who don't. That was self-evident. It was self-evident that there would always be monarchs. We were just in a bigger feudal system. It was not self-evident that all men were created equal. Oh, that's download. A new thought. Probably coming because there are a group of men who were sitting around saying, you know what, we're doing all this for this place over there, and they don't even care about us. They're not even taking care of us. They just want our taxes. What are we going to do? And they got still, and they started having some new thoughts. We hold these truths to be self-evident. We're also known as a truth teaching. We're truth students. So we're new thought, and we're truth students. And what I love is the verse out of the Bible that says, the truth shall set you free. And it's true. Whenever I'm stuck, I'm not telling myself the truth. Emma Curtis Hopkins says it this way: love cannot, not love, God cannot work in a lie, or either can love, actually. You cannot lie to yourself and expect freedom. You can't lie to yourself and expect things to change. The truth will set us free, but oftentimes that truth has to be a new thought. It has to be a thought that will penetrate through the stories we've told ourselves that confine ourselves. So what that means is that anytime you or I or someone out there, or a transgender kid in Milwaukee, or a gay couple in Texas that want to finally adopt, if they aren't free, that means that there is a lack of truth going on, brothers and sisters. Thank you. And that the truth needs to be known, proclaimed, spoken, shared, shouted, or paraded. Lots of color. As a nation, I'm going to do two things here. I'm going to talk about history so you can see how this works, and then we're going to open it up to you. Because this is not a philosophical teaching. We don't just, I can't anyway, I don't. I'm not sure that all the ministers in New Thought don't do it this way, but I don't give you a principle and not give you tools to work with it immediately. But I want you to see the principle in action by us looking at our history. We as a nation enslaved people because we were unwilling to tell the truth of their humanity. I'm not saying you did it. I'm not saying your grandparents did it. I'm saying we as a nation in our history enslaved people because we refused to say they were human. You don't brand something that's human. We kept women repressed by not telling the truth of their equality. And we kept millions of people in the sexual closet by not telling the truth about their dignity. And yet, if we really had listened to our heart, we would have known that life is life, and life is, if it's human, it has equality with every other human, and it has dignity because it lives. Whoa, the room got quiet. So I'll tell you a joke. That's actually the truth. But it is a joke on me. If I keep talking about this, then it's actually going to shift me, so bear with me. Sometimes have these little nuggets. I have these nuggets about things, like just these little downloads. Like one of the truths that I woke up for myself, and I also woke up for some other people, like the money ministry we're going to have tomorrow, is that too many people postpone their good till they have more money. But money shows up as the effect of you having a high intention. We treat money like cause, and money's always effect. And I thought about that for myself because I'm looking at my own cash flow and noticing that my cash flow went down. But when I was meditating about I want more money, the voice said, well, what would you use it for? You've got everything you want. What's your plan? Oh, if I want something, the money will follow. That's my big download of truth. I should put that in a segment. I have all these little pithy little ideas, and I'm thinking, oh, I could be teaching these pithy little ideas. So I've been saying I was going to write a book. I've got these ideas. I need to write a book. I will have ideas, and then they're gone, but because I haven't wrote them down. By the way, I believe that the Declaration of Independence was powerful because they had the idea, they talked about it, and then they wrote it down and shared it. Emma Curtis Hopkins' formula for truth changing your life is know it, speak about it, write it down, share it. So many of us know things, but we don't talk about it. So many of us know things, but we don't write it down, and we certainly don't share it. No wonder we are best kept secret in Seattle. Miracles are happening. I hear about them all the time, but it's just like, you know, I don't want to be too, you know, out there, but man, this thing happened, and it was really wild. But I don't want to seem, you know, braggadocious. Oh, come on. God changed your life. You didn't do it. There's nothing to brag about. Anyway, so I've got this whole idea for a book. And it came to me Friday night that my idea for a book is the same as what I experienced when I worked as a vet tech for a veterinarian, which was my very first full-time job. And I don't know if you know it, but there are dogs that have false pregnancies. They've been in the house. It's not an immaculate conception, but they get big, they get milk, they gestate, and then all of a sudden they go around in a corner and they think they've had babies. And they'll gather things like socks and old toys and stuff and bring them into their little nest. And it's like they're now like mamas. They had a false pregnancy. I've had a false book. I have all these ideas, but it's not real until you put it down on paper. Some of you have had false inspiration. You have this great idea, but you don't act on it. It's not real. It's not real until you speak about it. Write it down, share it, make it real, which is what our founding fathers did. What I've noticed is that this, if I had a book, it might be called The Tale of Two Realities, in which it was the best of times and it was the worst of times, but that opening has been used. But honestly and truly, think about it. It is the best of times, it is the worst of times. For minorities and women, we have it better than we've ever had it. For minorities and women, it's better than it was 100 years ago. As a woman, I can vote. I want to know what's happening with women that they are not voting for their own rights because, frankly, we're not a minority. There's 51% of us. And yet it is the worst of times. Because once you start to wake up, you see how far there is to go. Once you wake up, you are hurt when other people's hurt. We are exposed to atrocities and it hurts. And yet, according to statistics and those people who take counts of those things, the world is more generous, there's less poverty, there's less violence than there's ever been. But those poverties and those injustices and that violence hurts for those of us who are waking up. And what I was thinking about how precious a time this is, so it should be, this is the best of times, this is the worst of times, and this is the powerful of times. Because perhaps, like our founding fathers, we are faced with something that makes absolutely no sense, and we must be open to a divine download, to proclaim a new future, to proclaim something different, because the way it is not acceptable. Now that's for us as a culture, but it also has to be true for us as individuals. It has to be true for me. I have to be willing to see where I stop myself and what is the lie I'm telling myself so I can then say the truth. So Sherry has the microphone. And you're going to have an opportunity to help us with this, that we co-create this, the rest of the service together, by saying something that is stopping you so that you can come to your truth that will set you free. Now, I'll give you an example. It wasn't shared first service. It was shared after the service. I love it. Still, people sneak over. Didn't want it. But it was so perfect. A young woman had been separated and divorced from her husband for a year and a half. And yet she still felt awful and guilty, even though she knew it was the appropriate thing for her to do for herself and her son. But she was still so worried about it, what it was had done to him, and did she make a mistake? And, you know, how many of you have ever made a mistake and then you fret? How many have fretted? Well, that takes the living joy out of life, doesn't it? Fretting? So I asked her, well, so what are you not telling yourself? And what she came to is this. She wasn't saying that if it was good for me and if it's good for my son, it has to be good for my ex-husband as well. And when she could get that it had to be good for her ex-husband, she could exhale and she could smile and she could move on. See, truth will set you free. And the truth is, God doesn't play favorites. God wasn't on her side. Well, if I got what I wanted, that means that he doesn't get what he wants. No, God's plan for us is that everybody gets what they want, and we can't figure that out. Great, good, that's why we have a God. So who wants to raise their hand? Come on, brave people. Your second service. You had more coffee than the others. I'll pick somebody if you don't raise your hand. Oh, no, that would be scary. I know the whole room is leaving. Lock the doors! Come on. First service can do this. You can do this. Who's stuck in any way? All right, right there. Very succinct. No story.
My good to give to the world.
What?
My occupation, what I'm supposed to be doing, my financial freedom, my gift to the world. I feel scattered.
You feel scattered?
Yes.
So you're not giving your gift to the world?
I am, just by being. But as far as an occupation, a job to show up in that lights me up and lights up those around me.
Okay. All right. So what are you telling yourself that keeps this in place, my dear?
That I'm too busy.
That you're too busy to pursue your chosen occupation.
Right.
Yeah. And busy people never get what they want.
My belief is that busy people are getting what they want.
So now tell me then, why is it that you're not having the job you want, honey?
To have the clarity to know that this is what it is. I want to do this and this and this and this and this.
So you haven't really chosen what would be yours. Yeah. So
you have lots of them.
Yeah. So you haven't really given the universe direction.
Right.
So, yeah, good. So what you got was confusion.
Yes.
Oh, isn't the universe perfect? This is good. So here's the deal. How many of you have been here? How many of you haven't been clear and then you wanted the universe to just give you something? Fix it. Okay, so there's a good for you. You ought to have it, and it's now clarity and focus.
Been praying for that for a long time.
And I bet the discussion is, I still don't know. See, everything is a prayer.
Right.
We are always having, and that, since I've known you for a while, it has been scattered.
Yeah.
And you have lots of choices. So I know, so what I would love for you to do is to up the scattered and the focus. So that means that it should be, this. If I was you and I was here, I would gather all the spiritual support I could. I'd make sure there was a prayer request all the time. I'd make sure I was in this prayer circle all the time. And really, it's nothing else except I want clarity for my next step. 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 And don't entertain. Wait for a download. Because you're entertaining. Do you see how if you're entertaining? It's like, that's not focused. And you've been there. So like, let's do focus now. So there is a good for you. And you ought to have it. And this may not be true for you, but just try it on. When I haven't known, it's because I knew that if I knew, I'd have to act. And that's just for any of you that want to catch that one. It may not be true for you, but there's a good for you and you ought to have it, and it's clarity that you can't avoid. Okay?
Yes.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
All right. Who else? Oh, it's way over here. Over on that side. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Because, so here's the lie. The lie is, I don't know, I haven't known, and in an intelligent universe where we are made in the image and likeness of God, which is intelligence, we have to admit there's a part of us that knows. We're just praying for that revelation. You're just praying for the revelation of what you already know. All right. No, right in the back with the cap. Didn't you have your hand up? No, who had the hand up? Oh, there you. Okay, I just made it the person behind you.
Well, I set an intention, and the universe is certainly providing it. And in the process, I got a job, and I'm moving to New Zealand. So in the meantime, I still have a business that I closed last year, and I have all of that. I still have to liquidate my entire household, my house, and I'm finding it hard to let go. And I find it difficult at times letting it go for pennies on the dollar.
Yeah.
And I know it's about attachment.
Yeah.
It's also about grief.
Yeah.
I've had a great life here.
Yeah.
I've had so many things come to fruition by setting an intention and practicing the principles here. And I'm trying not to beat myself up. But it's hard sometimes.
What do you beat yourself up about?
Because I'm not doing enough.
Oh. Okay, who has that conversation? So is God enough?
Yes, absolutely.
So can God show up enough as you?
Yes, and it is, and I see it.
But
it's the struggle.
I know, but now watch this, because this is, who hasn't done this very same thing? You know the truth, but you'd have this other thing. I love it that Rabbi Ted did a Shabbat ceremony on Friday evening after everybody had spoken. He said, shalom means wholeness. So what if you are in the right place, doing the right thing in just the right way? And to have that conversation would give you joy, right?
Absolutely, and freedom.
Yeah, so just if it sets you free, that's the truth.
And I pray for that all the time.
No, you don't. No, because prayer is what we do all the time. Your conversation about, I'm attached, your conversation about pennies on the dollar, your conversation about, I mean, I'm losing, is just as much a prayer. And see what it does to you? I mean, it's not like that's not a true experience, but if it's causing you great pain, then, and when I said you're doing the right thing at the right time, then you lit up. So it's not just the prayer when you're in your prayer, where however you pray, it's your commitment to your joy in the way that you think. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
And this is not just for her. We all do these things. We all have moments of inspiration. I'm doing the right thing. It always works out. I have intentions. God follows through. And that's also prayer. So we're going to do a prayer for, since this is in the room, I bet in the room there are people that want direction. I bet in the room there are people that would love to let go and have a hard time doing it. Just as an illustration, there was a gentleman here who, since we left Sandpoint, has been at this center two times, twice the Mountaineers, and this is the second time here. And he said, it's hard to be here because I don't like change. And I don't like change. I just about abandoned my spiritual community. But he was attached to a way. In a way, you're attached too. But who isn't attached? And it's like, who isn't? So to pray for you is to pray for all of us. And to pray for your clarity is to pray for all of us. I want clarity. And I want a divine solution to what I'm not clear about, too. Does that make sense? So anyone in? We in?
Yeah.
Okay, let's go. And I love it. Where two or more are gathered in the name of a high idea, which is the I am. And that is so much power. So we are here and generating power together that we would not know individually when we pray. That's one of the reasons why even the finest spiritual leaders that we know of always had a group around them. Solo can go ways, but not like a group. So I'm so grateful that you're so honest and that you're here and that you can let us pray and have the same uplift. So I just give thanks that I know that there's one life, and that life is God's life. And that life is perfect, which only means it's complete. Life is complete. I have all the intelligence. I have all the wisdom. I have all the security and safety and courage that I need. I am complete. And as I know that for myself, I know that for every person in this room. We are complete. We are whole. Nothing missing, nothing wrong. We reside in a state of inner peace, whether we know it or not. And so I give thanks that I can say for myself and encourage all of us to breathe into that peace, that great state of shalom, that great state of inner wholeness. And from that place, I speak my word, that great clarity is now being known wherever it needs to be known. For the intelligence of God is here. It is complete within us, around us, through us, and it has so many ways to reveal itself. There is no end to the ways that intelligence can download to lift us out of our stuckness. And so I give thanks that intelligence is working through the action of the Holy Spirit in us now, consciously and unconsciously, and we are getting the message over and over again by intuition, by someone speaking, the back of a cereal box. Everything is speaking to us that which we need to know. We are directed step by step by step so that we can unfold and be the glory of God in human form. And I give thanks that we are also discovering within ourselves a safety and a security and a completeness that does not need stuff. Stuff is stuff. Stuff comes and it goes and it goes and it comes and it is transitory. But what resides is our connection with the divine. And so I give thanks that each and every one of us can step out with great courage, knowing that the only thing that we will ever meet is the assurance that God is God, and it is doing what it needs to do to sustain us and allow us to thrive and to bear fruit. I am so grateful that our inner security and our inner homing device is allowing us to move through all the changes of our life with great grace. Because change will happen. Change is a constant, but so is the glory of God within us. And I give thanks that this glory of God is now downloading in this group and that group and that group and that group the solutions that we seek to the problems that we see, so that we can move forward in great confidence and not anxiety over the things that bug the hell out of us. That we may know the heaven of God's great grace. Thank you, God, for bringing us here, for allowing us to know truth intimately, personally, and powerfully, that we may know freedom for ourselves, for others, for our planet, for all the critters on it. And so it is.